Good morning to you all. Today, I'm very happy to stand before you and talk about this this topic about open practice. This is one of the important topics so far as general practitioners are concerned, because you are the one who are going to make a big difference to the subsequent management of the fracture. So I think it is often said that the fate of the compound fracture is decided by the person who sees them first. So you are the one who are likely to see them first in your day-to-day practice, and definitely you are going to be make an impact on this. Now coming to the what is open fracture. The definition of the open fracture. Earlier, I think we are well-versed with a nomenclature like compound fracture. So compound fracture was not a self-explanatory. It was rather confusing. So subsequently, over a period of time, they changed the nomenclature to open fracture. Now, commonly it is referred as open fracture in most of the books and in day-to-day conversation. This name itself is self-explanatory. Fine. Now, what is open fracture or compound fracture? It is one in which there is a breach in the soft tissue cover or envelope of the bone. Fine. It may be right over the fracture site, or it may be away from the fracture site. Wound may be away from the fracture site, but or in at times, the fracture hematoma is communicating with external environment. So compound fracture is the one where there is a disruption of the soft tissue envelope resulting in communication of hematoma or communication of fracture fragments with the exterior. So what is so special that this communication of hematoma to the exterior or exposure of the bone to the exterior makes it so compound? The simple reason is that exposure to the environment results in increase in its chance of contamination and infection and subsequent outcome of the fracture. So that's why it is being given a special importance in orthopedic practice, and also it is considered as an orthopedic emergency. Now there is something called technically compound fracture. So what is this technically compound fracture? Many a times you come across a fracture in the leg, and the wound is located near the ankle. Fracture is in the mid one third of the leg. Now, whether the hematoma is not communicating here, neither the bones are exposed. So what is this? Is it really a open fracture? Yes. What it is known as, it is a technically compound fracture. It means that it is difficult to say whether the wound is communicating or not in the emergency room. It is only when you take these cases to the operation room and explore the wound, then you will come to know, yes, it is really compound or not compound. So all these fractures are grouped as technically compound. Fine. So the wound is located in same segment as that of the fracture, but it is not overtly communicating. That's what is the definition. Fine. Now coming to the next thing, the open fractures are considered emergency. I told you why they are considered emergency, because many times they are contaminated by deadly bacteria which can risk the life and limb of the patient. That's why there is a great importance attached to this. It is said that earlier you detect these fractures and implement the treatment, the better it is. Because if you delay more than 6 hours, the chances of the infection are very high. If you treat earlier, the chances of infection are relatively less. Once the infection is there, it becomes a big problem for the healing of the wound, and often they result in non-union. Fine. Imagine a study has shown that an open fracture which was treated, detected and treated within 6 hours, the rate of infection was less than 7, whereas one that was treated after 12 hours later, the rate of infection was 22%. Because more you leave it, there is a colonization of the bacteria and the infection gets established. So that is how the importance is. Now coming to the evolution or the history of this open fracture. Fine. So it has made a wonderful history in the management of open fracture. And based on the history, it is divided into four periods. The period prior to World War I and II, that is prior to 1914 to 1940. And during World War II, and the era, they are classified as era of limb preservation prior to World War I, era of limb preservation in World War II, and era of infection control during 50s and 60s, and the present era, that is the era of preservation of function. Just I'll briefly narrate the history of these open fractures. Prior to 1914, the concept of debridement was not there. As a result, all these major open fractures of the femur, tibia, used to end up in 60 to 80% of mortalities. So to prevent the fatality, they were doing the amputation for a open fractures. This is prior to World War I. Fine. Now, during the era of Napoleon War, Napoleon surgeons, they found out the procedure of debridement. Debridement. And I think the credit is often given to Embryo Spahr and Jean Larry. Fine. And in the subsequent period, this was implemented. All the open fractures were debrided. It made a tremendous difference in the fatality, death rate of these open fractures. Suddenly, from 60 to 70% of fatality, the fatality reduced to 20%. So imagine, there was no antibiotic still. The debridement and open drainage of the wound made a very big difference. Fine. So in 50s and 60s, sulfonamides, penicillin, they all made the entry. And again, they made a big difference in the control of infection. Fine. And thereafter, the present era, lot of research and advancement has occurred in the orthopedic field in terms of the soft tissue cover. That is the plastic surgery, the wound debridement, the best of antibiotics, the irrigation, and stabilization. So this has resulted in the considerable mortality, morbidity, infection. Now we are treating an open fracture to preserve the original function. Fine. So in any case, we are going to preserve the life, the limb. We are controlling the infection. The present era strives to achieve the original function of the hand or leg. So that is how we have evolved over the period. Fine. Now, coming to the arrival of this debridement, I told you, that made a big difference in the World War II. So most of the wounds were debrided, left open. And as a result, the mortality came down tremendously. So again, in the 50s and the 60s, the transfusion of the fluids, blood transfusion, splinting, and early transport, air transport, they all contributed to the reduction in the mortality of the patients. Now coming to the etiology of the open fracture, the biggest reason, the biggest contributor of open fracture is the road traffic accident. Almost 60 to 70% of the compound fracture in our cities are contributed by the road traffic accident. Right? And then comes the penetrating injury. Penetrating injury is maybe an sharp object, or it may be a glass cut. And then comes the gunshot and missile injuries. And with the increasing this insurgency terrorism, they all have greatly contributed to the gunshot injuries and the blast injuries. And the other contributors in small percentage are industrial and sport injuries and the massive air accidents, the rail accidents, and the earthquake injuries. Fine. They also contribute to the open fractures. Now, coming to the, based on the size of the wound, damage to the soft tissue, the open fractures are classified into three groups. Fine. So, type 1, 2, and 3, and this is commonly known by the name Gustilo-Anderson classification of 1984. So here, the type 1, where the wound is less than 1 centimeter, it is often the sharp fragment of the bone has penetrated the skin and it resulted in open fracture. So the amount of contamination is very less here, and the fractures are often caused by low energy injuries, and they are often transverse fracture, oblique fracture. There is hardly any comminution. Right. Now, coming to the type 2 fractures, here again, the size of the wound is little bigger, more than 1 centimeter, but less than 10 centimeter. There is some amount of muscular damage here, and there could be some comminution. Minimal comminution may be there. They are classified as type 2 wounds. Now, coming to type 3, they are basically bigger wounds, more soft tissue damage and periosteal stripping. Fine. And again, type 3 is divided into 3, A, B, and C. In type A, the wound is large, the damage to the muscle is extensive, but you can cover the bone with the soft tissue. Fine. So that's how you can prevent the further infection. Whereas in case of type 3B, after debridement, you are not able to cover the wound with the muscle or skin. So you require a surgery, plastic surgery, to cover the exposed bone. So they are classified as 3B. Now coming to the 3C. 3C again, the size of the wound is bigger, but the quantum of soft tissue may not be extensive, but what is more serious here is the vascular injury. Vascular injury which requires repair or reconstruction. Fine. So these are the various types of the open fracture. Now the basis of classification of this Gustilo-Anderson is, one is the contamination. Number two is the extensive damage to the soft tissue. And third is the energy, severe injuries, high energy injuries, whether it is a simple fracture or whether it is a comminuted fracture. So that way, I'll give you various examples of this type of injury. Now just see here, there's just a penetrated small injury and underneath there is a fracture. So this shows that there is a little contamination, and after debridement, you can close the wound and you can treat it like any other closed fracture. Now coming to the type 2. Here, the wound is bigger, more than 1 centimeter, and the muscles are minimally damaged. Again, after the debridement, you are able to close the wound. Now coming to the more severe type of injuries, where there is extensive damage to the soft tissues. Extensive damaged bone is exposed and there is comminuted fragment of the fracture. So as a result, so where you can cover the wound with a muscle or skin, it is known as 3B. And if you cannot cover, then it becomes a 3B. And the last one is the vascular injury. Just see here, the popliteal artery and the tibial artery, they are damaged. And as a result, it makes the open fracture as 3C. It is the more severest form of injury. Why? Because one, there is a comminution and vascular injury. When there is a vascular injury, the viability of the tissues is compromised. Anything you do, the fractures will not heal, they result in complication. Many a times they go in for amputation. Now, coming to the principles of management. Here, whenever a case of open fracture comes to you, you need to know how the injury was sustained and where the injury was sustained. There is a special significance attached to the injuries that are sustained in farms, barnyards, and in those places where there is a fecal contamination, because these are the places where there is extensive clostridial infections contamination is likely, and they pose greater threat to the open fracture. Now, take the history of comorbidities. Many people who have got diabetes, the hypertension, all these people have got a higher morbidity rate. And accordingly, you can control their condition and take them off for surgical stabilization. Now, coming to the physical examination. First and the foremost in the physical examination is all these open fractures are associated with high energy injury. There may be, in addition to fracture, there may be other injuries, like injury to the chest, injury to the abdomen, head injury, spine injury. So that may be there, and you need to rule out all these injuries first, because they are life threatening. Right? Now, then you evaluate the vascular status of the limb, whether the circulation is there or it is compromised. Then the neurological examination of the limb. Then whether there is any associated dislocation. So some of these things, basic things you need to examine. Right? Document all this, where it is located. So that, because most of the times, because of the road traffic accident, they are also medico-legal cases, and the documentation need to be done. So here again, you need to see how much soft tissue injury is there, and evaluate for the radiological examination. Most of the time in all these cases, there is just X-ray of the part, AP lateral view is required, and nothing more than that is required. However, there are associated injuries are there to the other systems. Yes, other investigations will be required. Now, coming to the principles of treatment for open fracture by the medical officer. As a medical officer, as a practitioner, so what are you supposed to do when a case comes to you? Yes, whenever such case come to you in your OPD, there is a wound. Fine, there is no point in exploring this wound in the open setup, because we are likely to push the infection further deep into it. Cover the wound with just wet sterile gauze, and put a pressure bandage so that some amount of hemostasis is achieved. Fine, and then don't use any chemical irritants like povidone, iodine, or any other antibiotic, because in any case, this is going to be explored in the OT setup. Now, next most important thing is the splinting. Splinting, most of the time, it may be Thomas splint, or it is a Kramer wire splint, or maybe an aluminium splint, where there is a lining with the sponge. So the splinting is very important for the simple reason that whenever you transfer the patient from your emergency room to the X-ray, there is going to be a movement of the part. It causes more damage to the soft tissue, and it may also result in damage to the nerves and the vessels. And also it causes severe pain. So just to prevent all this, you need to just splint with whatever splint is available to you. Now then comes the injection tetanus toxide. Then comes the antibiotic. Since this patient, you need not any establish a particular the organism, because that takes time. Fine. So most of the time, the common culprit is either it is Clostridia, Staphylococcus, or Streptococcus. Based on that, you give pragmatic antibiotics like ciprofloxacin or ciprofloxacin. I'll come to the details of this later on. Fine. Then early transfer to an orthopedic establishment can be done. This is the role played by you, and I think you will be doing a very great job if you attend to these three things. One is cover the wound with a sterile mop, dress it for to prevent the bleeding and prevent further contamination. Fine. Then splinting of the fracture with any splint you have, either it is a POP slab, Thomas splint, Kramer wire, aluminium, whatever is available in your setup. Then give the injection tetanus toxide, and then because these are injuries are sustained in roadside, in farms, in a dirty environment, the likely contamination with tetanus organism is very high. So then is the antibiotics and early transfer. This is a great. Now, it is said that when a treatment is started early, I told you already this part of the management. When you treat, start the antibiotics early, the rate of infection is very less. If you start late, then it becomes, rate of infection becomes very high. Okay, it is often said, which I already mentioned to you before, that the first medical officer which treats this case decides the fate of the compound fracture, open fracture. Fine. So now, coming to the definitive management. So what is the management in case of the open fracture in an orthopedic center? Again, same things it is done in case of a bigger hospital or in an orthopedic center. Rule out any associated injury to the head, to the chest, to the abdomen, because they are far more serious and these injuries risk the life. Once they are not there, then you also should look for ABC, airway, breathing, circulation. You must attend to those first. And then the open fracture is the last priority in this hierarchy. First ABC, then the associated injury, then the open fracture. Fine? Okay. Whatever antibiotic was given at your place, it can be continued. It is continued there in a hospital setup also. Now, the patient need to be taken for debridement. It is debridement, antibiotic is no replacement for the debridement. Debridement made a tremendous difference to the open fracture in the World War I and II. It drastically reduced the mortality by 3 times. And that's why the debridement is most important, right? Okay. And you do the debridement and then copious irrigation. I'll tell in greater detail in the next slide. Okay. At times, you're not able to make out all the dead tissue and you need repeated debridement 48 to 72 hours. The patient should be under your observation and he may require 2 or 3 debridements. Then after you do the debridement, next most important thing is the stabilization. Stabilization, yes, in minor fractures like type 1 and type 2, it can be internal fixation. In more serious fractures, it can be external fixation. Fine. So after the stabilization is done, next is cover the wound over the bone. Otherwise, if the bone is kept exposed, the chances of infection are very high and the bone necroses if it is exposed and it desiccates. Fine. The next step is to cover the soft tissue. Fine. And further is once you have covered the wound, then is there may be a bone gap. So that needs to be closed either by bone grafting or management of bone loss using a vascular graft or various other procedures. Once you have achieved the healing, then is the rehabilitation. Rehabilitation, that is weight bearing, movement, everything. So that is how the broad principles of management of open fracture in an orthopedic center. Now we'll elaborate more on this. A brief about the antibiotic protocol. Okay, use of early antibiotic, I already said, and antibiotic initiated as early as possible, the type of antibiotics that are given in type 1 and type 2 injuries, where there is hardly any great damage to the soft tissue, you can just give cefazolin, the first generation cephalosporins, or you can give ciforexime, which is third generation, which is basically active against the gram-positive organisms. Yes, when there is a crush injury in those situations, that is type 3 and 4, in addition to the gram-positive, you need to cover the gram-negative also. The commonest antibiotic that is used to cover the gram-negative is the gentamicin, which is given in the dosage of 3 to 5 milligrams per kg body weight per day. Fine. So this is about the antibiotics. Now, a brief about the wound culture. Whether is there any utility of wound culture in an open fracture? Yes. Most of the times what happens is, whatever culture you have taken from the wound, the same organisms are not there after the debridement. They are altogether different organism. As a result, the wound culture has got no relevance in open fracture, so it is not recommended. Fine. This is what I just told you. First generation in type 1 compound fracture, first generation cephalosporin is enough in type 1 and type 2. In type 3, you need to add some aminoglycoside, that is the gentamicin, or you may add vancomycin. Yes, in injuries which are sustained in a farm, barnyards, in a fecal contaminated areas, you add penicillin. Why you add penicillin is because the possibility of tetanus and clostridial contamination is there. And the tetanus and clostridium, they are extremely sensitive to the penicillin. They are yet to develop resistance to penicillin. That's why you give penicillin in type 3 and dirty contaminated wounds. Coming to the operative management. Okay, the patient has come to the OT. Now we need to debride the wound. Now I'll just briefly give the details. Now avoid using tourniquet. You can, why do you avoid? The reason is that most of the times the tissues are crushed and their viability needs to be decided on the table. And many a times, you need to see the bleeding, whether it is dead or alive. By applying a tourniquet, you are blurring this and you are causing further damage to the tissues. That's why the tourniquets are not used. So even if you are using, keep it in place in case there is a severe extensive bleeding, you can use it. Okay, yeah. Now then comes to prepare the skin, neighboring skin with antiseptic. And don't use antiseptic directly into the wound because they are very damaging. Now, coming to the debridement. Debridement is a term used to remove dead and necrotic tissue and to remove the foreign body, clot, everything. So this term was coined by the Desault, a French surgeon. Right? That's how we call it as a debridement. Its pronunciation varies based on the individual, but what it called is a debridement by us. It is just removal of dead necrotic tissue from the wound. Now, I'll give you the various steps of debridement. One, how do you deal with the skin? Skin in open fracture, most of the times either it is contused or crushed. All these crushed margins of the skin should be removed till the bleeding is seen. Don't remove excess skin because subsequently you need to cover the open fracture. Now, coming to the subcutaneous tissue and the muscle. All the fat that is loose, hanging, should be removed. Don't remove excess fat because blood to the skin comes from the subcutaneous tissue. Right. Now coming to the muscle. Muscle. They say that debride the muscle ruthlessly because muscle, crushed and dead muscle, is a good this culture media for the bacteria. So long the dead muscle remains, the infection will remain. Remove all the dead necrotic muscle. Now, next thing is, I was talking about tourniquet. Avoid using tourniquet, but if you are expecting bleeding, in that case, yes. Let the tourniquet be in place. Don't use, don't elevate the pressure. Fine. Now, I was talking about how to deal with the skin. All the crushed and contused skin margin should be excised, and it is seen that the bleeding comes from the cut margins. That is one of the indications. I was telling you about the muscle debridement. Muscles, when you are debriding the muscle, the principle of 4C is followed. One, first C is color. What is the color of the muscle? Is it dusky, dark red? If it is dark red, it is dead. You need to cut it. Number two, C is the contractility. The normal muscle, when it is cut, it bleeds. So if it is not bleeding, cut it. The third C is the consistency. Normal muscle is firm. And if this is soft, it is dead muscle. Okay. So then is fourth C is capacity to bleed. When you cut the muscle, it should bleed. If it is not bleeding, it is dead. So color, consistency, color, consistency, capacity to bleed, and contractility. These are the four C's. Now I am coming to the next. What do you do with the bone? So there may be a lot of bone fragments. If the bone fragments are free floating, so they act as a sequestrum, we should remove them. If the bone has got an attachment of the muscle, soft tissue, preserve it. Fine. Next, coming to the tendon. Coming to the articular surface, yes. If the articular surface is destroyed or it is incongruent, then make it congruent with fixation. It may not be immediately with the internal fixation, but with K-wire. Fine. And then is the irrigation. So irrigation is use of saline. Use saline extensively to wash the wound. It is said that the solution to pollution is the dilution. Aim is to use extensive saline to wash out all the debris mass. If you irrigate the wound, all the dead tissue will come out. All the clots, fat comes out. So the muscle looks more healthier. And if it is looking dead or dirty, you can always remove. That's how it helps. Don't use any antibiotic or antiseptics in the muscle. Okay. Now coming to the wound closure. If the wound is type 1 and type 2, close the wound. Because it is less than 1 centimeter, the damage to the tissue is less likely, and you can safely close and keep him under observation. The problem comes in type 3 wounds where there is extensive crushing and wound is very large. In those cases, where you can cover the bone, cover it. When it is not possible to cover the wound in a short period of time, within 3 to 5 days. And either by flaps or by musculocutaneous flap or muscular cover, whatever it is, by plastic reconstructive surgeries. Fine. Now, once the wound is covered, then comes the stabilization of the fracture. I told you why the stabilization should be done. It will help in preventing the damage to the tissues. It will help in healing of the bone. In type 1 and 2, which are minimally damaged open fractures, fix them like any other closed fracture, either with plating or with nailing. The problem comes in type 3 fractures. So type 3 fractures are treated by external fixators. Okay, external fixator. External fixator is minimally invasive stabilization system. Okay, unlike plate, which is quite extensive, and if you do any definitive fixation with plate and nail in a badly contused wound, the chances of infection are more. Fine. So you should use the external fixator. Now coming to the bone gap, how will you close the bone gap? Once the wound has healed, you close the bone gap either by the bone grafting or using a vascular fibula or using ELISARO method. ELISARO method is a procedure which transports the bone segment and helps in filling the gap. Okay, now coming to the outcome of open fracture. What is the outcome of open fracture? Yes, type 1 and type 2, the rate of infection is very minimal. Most of them, they can be treated with internal fixation after 2-3 days later. Whereas in case of type 3A, where you can only close the wound with a tissue, the chances of sepsis is 4. However, these patients do not go in for amputation. Now, type 3B, where the soft tissue damage is extensive, bone is lying exposed. So the chances of infection is 47% in these patients. Very few of them go for amputation. Now coming to the type 3C, where there is a vascular injury. The rate of infection is relatively less, but the number of cases that go for amputation is very high, 42%. So this is briefly about the emergency management and early management of the open fractures. If you have any queries, you are welcome to ask. Thank you very much for your patience hearing.